Welcome everybody to this CMCC webinar. I'm Giovanni Coppini and I will introduce and moderate the webinar. The webinar title is Drought and Floods, Complex Interaction in Rapidly Changing World. And Professor Giuliano Di Baldassarre from Uppsala University will speak. I will introduce briefly the CMCC. And then I will give the floor to Professor Di Baldassarre. CMCC mission, CMCC Foundation mission is to investigate and model our climate system. And then we focus on describing the climate interaction with society, with the final objective to provide a reliable, rigorous, and timely scientific in doing that, we want to inform stimulate the sustainable growth of our planet. And of course, protect the environment and develop science-driven adaptation and mitigation policies in this in our changing climate. We are ourselves already a network. Our foundation is distributed in Italy. So you see here in this slide the network of division. The division is the ultimate organization structure at CMCC. And here you see the list of divisions. So we have, these are research divisions. And as you see, as you can see, they are thematic. So we range from advanced computing capacity and the development of advanced algorithms to climate prediction, for instance, seasonal forecast, economic analysis, and the evaluation of climate impacts and policies. Then you have a thematic division in terms of domain of application. For instance, we have the one dealing with the terrestrial agriculture, the forest and ecosystems services. And then two divisions dealing with ocean, one more focused on modeling and data simulation, and the second one focused on more operational activities related to prediction and to added value products and application. Then the last three divisions deals with risk assessment and adaptation strategies, regional modeling, so focusing on downscaling especially, and geological hazards, and then and impacts, and then the last one more related to sustainable earth modeling economics. So main activities are related to, and the topics of our research, of the CMCC Foundation research, are related to modeling, policy adaptation, prediction impacts. So really a full range of capacity to be able to deal with climate change and especially propose solutions for adaptation and mitigation. Last but not least, the CMCC is a challenge to disseminate and outreach and promote our research and inform the public, the stakeholders, and the citizens. So we do it through several tools and activities. Of course, scientific publication, but not only scientific one, but the main focus, of course, being a research division is scientific publication. Then we organize many events, thematic events for the public, for the schools, for the policymaker. We do work a lot with the schools and also universities for education. For instance, we have a PhD course. And then we work on communication and climate literacy, on the social, we are present on the social media, and of course the webinar itself, they are an example of important example of communication. After the webinar, you will get the Q&A session. You can pose question through the control panel. Use the question tabs during the seminar. I will register them and then I will pose some of the questions to Professor Baldassarre. And last, just to inform you that this webinar is recorded and will be uploaded to the web. So you will find, and you can forward this information to colleagues that couldn't attend. You will find this webinar on the YouTube channel, so easily in Google CMCC video YouTube, you will find it, or on the CMCC website. For any further question about the webinar, you can use webinar@cmcc.net. So I've concluded my introduction. Give the presenter to Professor Di Baldassarre. Let me
okay. Good morning, everyone. I'm Giuliano Di Baldassarre from Uppsala University, and I'm a professor at Uppsala University in Sweden and the director of the Center of Natural Hazards and Disaster Science. And I'm really pleased to be here at CMCC Foundation based in Lecce and present about my work about droughts and floods, complex interactions in a rapidly changing world. Humanity is facing a global water crisis. What we see in this slide is a recent survey that we made across different water scientists and experts in the world, at the American Geophysical Union, AGU, and the International Association of Hydrological Sciences. And on the left-hand side, we see different types of water crises that are being experienced in different parts of the world. They range from increasing flood risk to increasing drought risk. While on the right-hand side, we have different factors that are that have been identified by water experts as the main ones causing these different types of crises. They range from growing population, increasing water demand, building large dams, to a changing climate. What we can see in this diagram, the most striking result is that most water crises are in fact a complex web of interactions between social, technical, and hydrological factors. And this is indeed what multiple scientists around the world are trying to face, which is the Pantarei Everything Flows, which is the research decade of the International Association of Hydrological Sciences. What we have here, we have more than 300 water scientists that are working and trying to understand the way in which hydrology and society shape each other. There is, in fact, a very long history of understanding the link and the interplay between water and society. 2,500 years ago, Heraclitus, to express the concept that nothing is permanent except change, he actually referred to water and people. He said that no man ever steps in the same river twice, for it's not the same river and it's not the same man. I will try to express this by looking at the today Anthropocene and the way in which humans continuously alter the hydrological extremes and therefore the frequency, magnitude, the spatial distribution of droughts and floods. This human influence is both deliberate or accidental. We can have deliberate influence such as building water infrastructure, such as reservoirs. What we see in this video is how during the past 100 years, multiple reservoirs have been influencing the hydrology of large rivers around the world. And another aspect is also that the human influence can also be incidental. land use change, such as deforestation, urbanization, they all have an influence on the hydrological streams, and as such, they have an influence on the frequency, magnitude, and spatial distribution of droughts and floods. While society shapes the hydrology, and in particular, droughts and floods, hydrology, droughts and floods, also shape society, as humans continuously respond to the occurrence of hydrological streams. This type of response can be formal response, such as conservation measures, water restrictions that are posed, for instance, during drought conditions. What we see in this diagram is water consumption in Cape Town for different social groups. So we see from the informal dwellers to the upper class. What we can see in this diagram are different things. The first one, which is very striking, is that different social groups have different levels of water consumptions. We have informal dwellers that are struggling every day with a continuous water crisis, and the upper class, which is enjoying the swimming pool. But also we see how hydrological conditions can shape this water consumption. We have the drought onset at the beginning of this time series, and then we see a drop in water consumption during the start of the restriction in the last drought event, which was known as day zero. This day zero was a big water crisis in Cape Town, which occurred between 2015 and 2017. And then what we see is that after this water crisis, the water consumption is now going back to the original status. So what we see is the impact of hydrology on society. We also see that poor people, in fact, they are always facing with a water crisis. And for them, they say, it's always day zero. They are always struggling with access to water. Another way in which humans respond to hydrological extremes, droughts and floods, is also informal, more spontaneous approaches, such as migration from drought-prone areas or flooded area. And we see that in some instances, especially when there is a lot of dependence on agriculture, the occurrence of droughts and floods may also be an additional trigger for armed conflict. So what we see in the Anthropocene is that we have a mutual shaping of hydrology and society. This relationship goes in both directions. And if we focus on droughts, for instance, there has been a lot of research over the past few years trying to understand the propagation of droughts in the Anthropocene. In this diagram, we see a traditional drought propagation. We start from climate variability, and the climate variability may induce some anomaly on precipitation and temperature, which leads to meteorological drought, so for instance, less rainfall than normal, which may or may not propagate into soil moisture drought, so we have that soils are drier than normal, which can eventually become hydrological drought when we have less water in rivers and lakes than normal conditions. And this has ecological and socioeconomic impacts. However, this type of cascade, which is very much top-down, is in fact much more complex in the Anthropocene. There are multiple human activities that influence the way in which drought generates and propagates from the air to the ground. We have anthropogenic climate change in the first place, which has an influence on climate variability, which is an indirect way in which human activities through CO2 emissions have an influence on drought generation. And then we have locally direct influence on drought propagation, such as land use change, irrigation, dam building, the presence of reservoirs, and abstraction of water as an influence on which can alleviate or exacerbate drought propagation. And then based on the ecological impacts and the socioeconomic impacts of drought, humans respond, as I showed before, through formal and informal measures. So these responses in turn change human activities and they have a feedback on drought propagation. So we have again feedback interactions and a very complex interplay. This is indeed the main focus of social hydrology. Social hydrology has been growing over the past years, in which more and more we see more and more scholars that try to understand and model the type of phenomena that are generated by the mutual shaping of hydrology and society. The focus is on the feedback between human and water systems and the dynamics that are generated from this type of feedback. It builds on a very long history of trying to understand water resources systems, IWRM, which is Integrated Water Resources Management, and the study of socio-ecological systems, such as as well as coupled human nature systems. I would like to speak a little bit about this phenomena. So those phenomena are counterintuitive dynamics or paradoxes that emerge when we try to fix some water crisis, some type of problems, and then we get backfired in the long term. An example is the safe development paradox, which is also known in the flood community as the levee effect. In this case, we see that flood protections are put in place, such as levees, to protect some areas, but this may generate a very big occupation of the floodplain. We have more people living in the floodplain, unaware of risk, and when the levee eventually fails, we have increasing flood losses. The second one is the supply-demand cycle. This occurs when reservoirs are put in place to secure water supply, but by securing water supply, they increase water demand. They can generate an accelerating spiral of agricultural intensification or urbanization, which can then make much worse water shortages when the next prolonged drought occurs. A third one is the adaptation effect. We are often concerned about more frequent events or flood-rich periods, for instance, in which flooding is very frequent. But we also see that as humans respond to hydrological extremes, in some instances, frequent events are also associated with decreasing losses. And lastly, but not leastly, we have the sequence effect, which is when human response to droughts may make the next floods much worse. A typical example is when reservoirs are operated, and to respond to droughts, reservoirs are kept as full as possible. But then if a flood occurs shortly after, there is not enough volume to attenuate floods, and flood propagation downstream is much worse. So all these phenomena can be understood by looking at the type of mechanism that generate this phenomena. If we understand them, we can then anticipate their emergence. Over the past few years, different system dynamic models have been developed to explain past changes of hydrological risk with reference to both droughts and floods, and also explore future trade-off when we make new decisions. What we see here as an example is a model that we developed a few years ago in which we see five main variables: flooding, wealth, levees as a flood protection proxy, the distance to the river, and the social memory of society. And in this type of model, which is here schematized with this causal loop, is based on system on differential equations, which I skip here for the sake of time, which identify the accumulation of flood memory as a primary mechanism to explain the emergence of two main phenomena that we see in human flood interactions. The adaptation effect, so that frequent events can be associated with decreasing losses, which seems paradoxical, and the levee effect, so the aforementioned safe development paradox. I show here an application of this model. This has been based on two archetypes of human societies and the way in which they cope with flooding. So we have two flood management strategies. They are simplified. One is a green system, in which what we see is that this community mainly deal with flooding through non-structural measures. So they try to reduce the floodplain occupation. So it is mainly about resettling outside from the floodplain. While on the right-hand side, we have a technical system in which levees are built, so structural measures are built, and this allows an occupation of the floodplain. So if we look into the results of the model, I'm not giving details, but the key idea is that in the green system, flood memory is refreshed more often. There is a closer relationship between the river and the community. And this also leads to the adaptation effect. We have in the periods, for instance, around the 1960s to 1990s, we have similar flood events with decreasing damage as people learn to cope with flooding. So it's a living with floods approach which leads to decreasing losses over time. On the right-hand side, we have a technical system. In this case, many flood events are prevented. We have levees that prevent high levels in the rivers to result into flooding in the floodplain. If you see the changes in memory in time, after the 1950s, we can see that there is a decay of memory as people as well as institutions tend to forget the relevance of flooding. And then when a big flood occurs in 2040, the damage is very relevant, is catastrophic. This is very similar to what we have seen, for instance, in New Orleans in 2005. So very high level of flood protections that prevent flooding for many generations, and when flooding occurs, becomes catastrophic. So what we see here is the model capturing these two main phenomena that are key to understand how flood risk changes in time. But the key point is the trade-off. Which one is the preferred options? Here we have two extremes, green system and technical systems. So typically it is these type of models are done to try to understand how flood protections on the one end reduce the frequency of flooding, but can also backfire by increasing the vulnerability. But it's always a matter of trade-off, because if you look into the two communities, you can also see that the technical system has developed much more than the green system. So on the one end, we have that living with floods may lead to adaptation, but can also limit economic growth. The reason why I'm emphasizing the trade-off is because nowadays trade-offs are key, especially as most countries around the world are mobilizing resources to address the sustainable development goals. And what we have different targets, different goals that can have synergies as well as conflicts. So the key point is to try to find a trade-off between different targets. And I will now, in this second part of the presentation, show the type of trade-off that we can have in water-related issues, such as droughts and floods. So in this diagram, which is difficult to read, I have plotted all the different socio-hydrological phenomena versus SDG targets that are related to water. To better focus this, I will continue speaking about the safe development paradox and focus on a few targets, which is the 8.1, sustained per capita economic growth, the 11.5, reduced death from water-related disasters, and the 13.1, strength and resilience to climate-related hazards. So using the model I've shown before, we can see how the green and technical system have a different evolution of wealth over time. You can see here, for instance, if we follow the red line, that we have high slope, which means that economic growth is very rapid, but then we also have these drops, which are rare, but when there is drop, the drop is very significant, which are the flood damage. So when they occur, the flood damage is big. While on the green system, we have that flood damages are very small, but they grow slower, so there is less growth. So this type of models can allow this to find trade-off between, for instance, in this case, sustain economic growth, while at the same time trying to reduce death from water-related disasters. I will continue about this trade-off. As many of the socio-hydrological phenomena I expressed before are very much, can really be seen as a legacy. If I go back to the supply-demand cycle, the supply-demand cycle is when, by securing water supply in dry areas, we promote agricultural intensification, and this may backfire when drought events occur. We see this in many parts of the world, arid areas of the world, the most notably in California, for instance, there is heavy reliance on water resources, which has been made available through a complex system of water infrastructure. And now, anytime we have a drought, there are very critical water crises. The same applies to the South Africa, the example of Cape Town which I made before. Cape Town is in a very arid region, and a complex system of reservoirs has made possible to have a large population in this area, and also an agricultural intensification connected with wine production. This is a legacy because now when we have drought events, the impacts are catastrophic. So the point of legacy is that as the past was a legacy of the present is a legacy of the future. And this is important because this means that the decisions we make now in water resources management and planning will have an influence in the future. So we should try to avoid short fixes that may backfire in the long run. If you look into this diagram, I show the example of having a performance of a certain policy. This is very generic. And this performance we try to monitor over time. This is what is being done with the Sustainable Development Goals. And if one looks into this diagram, and we have two types of policy, and let's say that we can anticipate the outcome of this policy, I would expect that most of us would go for the long-term policy. But reality is that we have two problems with this. The first problem is that it's very difficult to anticipate what is going to happen at the end of the century. The second one is that the Sustainable Development Goals are meant to have precise targets by 2030. Which to me is actually more a short, medium term. And trying to reach this target by 2030 may also lead to this kind of fixes that backfire in the long term. I provide a clear example by decomposing the two policies here, short term and long term. On the left hand side, as an example, I show the short term policy trajectory as a composite of two SDG targets. One is the goal of increasing GDP per capita, and the other one is to preserve the extent of water-related ecosystems. So one is an ecological target, and the other one is an economic priority. So what we see here is that in the short-term policy, GDP is growing very rapidly, but this is going to the expense of the environment. So environment is being exploited. So by 2030, the situation is still positive. But because of the legacy, the environment keeps on being exploited. It goes to environmental degradation, and at some point we have a crisis and the GDP decreases over time. On the right-hand side, we have a long-term policy. In this case, the GDP is also growing, but not as rapidly as on the short-term policy, because there is more attention in keeping the different ecosystem functions and preserving the environment. So what we see here is that the environment is slightly degraded, but not too much. And the GDP keeps on growing, and this gives a more sustainable trajectory, which keeps on being on the positive slope also after 2030. So by concluding my talk, I've been speaking about droughts and floods and their complex interactions with human society in a nowadays rapidly changing world. The presentation has been showing how system dynamic models and also the understanding of human water interaction can help us trying to model and also understand the short and long term effects of different water policies and strategies. And this includes capturing the paradoxes and phenomena that we often face in the Anthropocene. Another key point is trying to represent different type of consequences to find a trade-off between economic, social, and environmental priorities, and capture both intended effects and unintended consequences of different type of measures. One aspect that more and more scientists are looking at is also how, when we look into water management and planning, and we try to deal with droughts and floods, we have to be very careful in implementing large infrastructure, as this can also lead to uneven distribution of cost and benefits across social groups, which is the issue of water justice that I briefly mentioned about Cape Town and South Africa at the beginning of this presentation. So, with this, I would like to thank you for your attention, and I welcome questions about the seminar. Thank you again.
Thank you, Giuliano. Thank you so much. It was a very interesting seminar. I leave first. I will organize the discussion like that. First, we get the questions from the room in Lecce, where the webinar is physically taking place at the Ocean Prediction and Application at CMCC site. Then I'll post some questions, and then there are questions from the web, from the web participants. Just to inform you that we had almost 100 participants along all the webinars, so very, very populated seminar. So please, if you have questions to Giuliano in Lecce, otherwise I will have one.
Yes, I'm Gianandrea Mannarini here in Lecce. And like, first of all, to thank Professor Di Baldassare for this visionary talk. I appreciated especially the effort to make a joint modeling of the natural and societal systems and to introduce variables such as memory or short, long-term policy. My comment is more about the role of formal education in shaping the impact of, to assess the impact of natural disasters, since I believe formal education may affect both memory and the decision for either short or long-term policies. And I think formal education is also part of SDGs. So I would like just to ask if you are intended to, if it's possible to make a modeling including the level of formal education, what are the challenges in your opinion? Thank you very much.
Yeah, thank you very much for your question. Indeed, education is key, and being an academic, I believe in education very much. Is one of our mission is to educate future generations of experts and non. So the definitely when it comes to the representation of human-natural interactions, education is something that can be considered and it is being considered, especially when it comes to the level of risk awareness with respect to different type of natural hazards. What we do, not only through models, but also through field work. We do different surveys, also longitudinal analysis, in which we try to look at how risk awareness changes over time, and also this effect about having some type of natural hazards. So today I focus on droughts and floods, but this applies also to earthquakes, for instance, generates a very high level of awareness, which then decays over time. And what we see through empirical evidence is that the higher is the level of education and the slower is this process of decaying memory over time. So this is something which, if we want, we can include into the model.
Thank you, Giuliano. Any other question in Lecce? I have one. I was reflecting that, as you know, we work on the ocean domain. So, of course, the connection with the hydrology, for instance, for flooding is fundamental. But then I was wondering how you consider the seasonality of, let's say, the usage of the territory and the fact that, for instance, some of the storm may occur mainly in the autumn or winter season, while some of the decisions, for instance, in the coastal areas to construct, beaching facilities, deals with the need of society that is more specifically for the summer period. So the perception of the problem is even more complex because the solution you might propose is not relevant for the people that have the need, or is not, let's say, it is relevant, but is not perceived as relevant. So do you deal with that level of complexity?
Yes, thanks, Giovanni, for the question. This is very relevant. In fact, in my presentation, I focused on droughts, floods, and decadal timescales. since this was somehow connected to different type of policies such as SDGs, climate change adaptation and disaster risk reduction. But when you look into everyday water management, seasonality is indeed key. It's very crucial. And what we try to do, not only through models, but also through fieldwork, is to capture these different priorities across different seasons for water managers, as well as for the interested stakeholders and the general public. So indeed, this complicates the picture. And also what complicates even further is that these different time scales, decadal versus seasonal, also interacts and generates unexpected dynamics.
Okay, I have one last question from my side before moving to the web questions. In the South Africa case, I saw that the cons after the restriction, the consumption of the richest people was even higher than before, while the lower population adapted to, it looks like it adapted to a lower consumption. So is it
Yes.
what is the reason behind?
Well spot. Well spot. I didn't want to go into the details, but indeed, this is our interpretation. We are carrying out field work. As we have seen, the paper is under review. So this is something we are still trying to validate. But based on interviews and on the data that we could retrieve, we found that the upper class has found new sources of water from during the water crisis. So they are now starting with desalination plant, also borehole wells were drilled, which means that now after the droughts, they have access to more water resources than before. While others have been forced to reduce also their long-term water consumption.
Thank you, very, very interesting. So now I have several questions from the web. I will try to go through since we have still time. First question is from the Asabe Shehu Foundation. So they are asking, what plans do you have for the people in the community that are most affected by flood? So let's say, what are the adaptation strategy that you foresee?
Yes, well, the adaptation strategy is most appropriate always depends on the specific context. So there is one of my points also in the presentation is that there is no clear-cut answer. The idea that on the one hand I've been challenging during my career, the idea that relying on high level of flood protections, for instance, leads us to less flood risk, since we can have all these safe development paradoxes, lag effects, which may offset the benefit of flood protection. But on the other hand, I'm not advocating for not protecting because we also see, for instance, many countries around the world, like Bangladesh, in which indeed they've been adapting to floods, but also this has prevented them to grow economically. So the question is always about trade-off between different type of priorities, ecological, social, environmental, and this strongly depends on the context. What we try to offer here is a methodology to explore this trade-off.
Thank you, Giuliano. Then Giuseppe Mariano is asking, he was fascinated by the concept of memory. Partially, I think you have already answered to the question that it was how do you record and select the memory? So what is the methodology behind that? Maybe you mentioned interview.
Yes, indeed.
What is more, can you elaborate a bit more?
Yes, so I can elaborate a little bit more. As I mentioned before, some of my colleagues are working on doing surveys in different places around the world in which we what we track, we try to use, we look into flood memory over time. So we make questionnaires and surveys with the general public, and also we repeat this over time. So this is called longitudinal analysis, so that we can also see whether memory is indeed being accumulated after the event and how this decays over time. But there are also some proxies that can be used for memory. In some countries, for instance, there is flood insurance. So flood insurance can also be a proxy. What we see after the occurrence of flood events, we have more people that buy flood insurance, and then they start, and then we see also a decay over time. Other scientists, I'm not using it myself, but other scholars have been also using doing media analysis, so looking into the newspapers. How often do we mention some keywords as a proxy of the memory?
Okay, now a bit more technical question, and I add one of my comments. So Vanya Pakan is asking what kind of software was used for the modeling, and which are the techniques that you deal to model, let's say, to deal with the absence, lack of data while modeling.
Yeah. Okay, so in terms of...
Is it your model an open source code or community model?
Yes, so it is open source because the model is written, the model code is written in R, and it is available on our website, www.hydrosocialextremes.org, and also as a supplementary material to most of our publications. So it is freely available. And it is open source. In terms of how to use the model in data poor areas, one of the ideas of these models is to keep them simple, because essentially they are tools to explore different options, plausible futures, and trying to interpret past changes. So the idea is to keep them simple was also to deal also in areas in which we don't have much information. And so one can, in this case, can use more like a scenario-based approach. So if-then approach. So if the system is based on this assumption, then we see this type of dynamic emerging. But indeed, it's very important not to do modeling alone. So modeling always comes with many other activities, such as field work and also working with the different stakeholders in the specific context.
Thank you, Giuliano. Then another question. Sorry, it's very long. Lisa will take it later. Sorry, too many questions. If you can elaborate a bit more on how you model, it's a bit of a general question, the economical, ecological, social interaction. So what is the main methodology?
Yeah, okay. So the main methodology is based on inductive, deductive approach. So what we typically do, one can think in these terms. We start with a hypothesis about the interactions between ecological, social, and environmental priorities. And then we test this into specific case studies in which we have abundant information. And once we have refined the model, we try to see what type of implications we have in other places that were not among our case studies. And then we see whether the implications of our models are indeed observed in other places around the world. If this is not the case, we reiterate and we adjust the model.
Okay, thank you. So we have a compliment from Paola Vesco, who is a PhD candidate at CAF Foscari, And she gave exactly the same question about South Africa. So I won't repeat it. She already got the question, but I wanted to give you her compliments. Then let's go. So how can the green system be implemented in already urban areas such as big city or big towns? This is a question from John Wilson.
Yes, so this is very much about the issue of legacy. So once that, so the concept of legacy when it comes to the urban areas which are already developed in the floodplain, it is essentially impossible or implausible to remove them. It's like if you think of the most striking example is the Netherlands, which is heavily urbanized in flood-prone areas. And this is really a legacy of the past. And typically, it shows it's a kind of reinforcing loop. So we start with flood protection. The area is more habitable, so we have urbanization of this area. So it requires higher flood protection, so we increase the protection. If we increase the protection, this becomes even more desirable, so we have more people living here. And then we need more protection, and then even more people. So you get kind of lock-in condition. So indeed, it is at that point it becomes very not popular and in fact unfeasible to switch into a green system. And this is exactly my point about legacy. So this is why we have to be careful, because maybe we think that it's just a quick fix for today, but what we do today will influence into the future and can put us into an accelerating spiral towards a state which might be desirable in some contexts, maybe the Netherlands, but not in other contexts.
And in fact, this link to the next question from Tushara Agarwal that is mentioning how does a natural-based solution fit into analysis. Maybe you could elaborate a bit on how you have, because natural-based solution is really a new domain, even if is known, but now is quantified, the importance. So can you elaborate a bit?
Yes, well, thanks also for this question. So the nature-based solutions, as we know, it is many things, in fact. There are different types of solutions, and it is a buzzword which is being used for including both approaches that are kind of structural approaches, because maybe the levee is made with a nature-based material, but it's still a levee, it's still decreasing the probability of flooding. Or indeed it is more similar to the green system. So this is why I didn't emphasize it, because in reality nature-based solutions does not discriminate between whether or not the community is either adapting to floods or fighting floods. You can still fight floods with nature-based solutions.
Just give me 1 second. So I will read the next question because it's a bit long and complex. Ramesh is mentioning that in his experience, he has seen some community getting affected by both flood and droughts in a year, especially in West Africa community during monsoon and then later dry seasons. How do you or can we consider risk mapping for both the extreme events together, or do you have a suggestion and ways to develop an adaptation approach in this case, complex case?
Yes, thanks also for this question. This is really, really important to consider both extremes together. This was also why I, in the presentation, I tried to speak both about droughts and floods. For the sake of time, I didn't speak too much about the interactions between the two extremes, apart when I mentioned about the sequence effect. But indeed, since water management has an influence on both, we should consider them together and also map them together. And there have been many efforts, especially over the past few years, because the drought community has been traditionally very much separated from the flood community and vice versa. They kind of have been working in parallel, But we see that indeed, since humans interact with both extremes and the response to one may make the other extreme more severe, we need to consider them together. This applies even more in many places in the world that are indeed facing both droughts and floods.
Thank you. Now another question by Catherine von Stackerberg. She's asking, doesn't the focus on GDP as a metric of success only reinforce environmental degradation? How do we reconcile continued economic growth in a constrained planet? How can economic growth ever be sustainable? So it's a bit of a realistic, let's say, question.
Yes.
Do you have an opinion on that?
Yeah, so yes, I have an opinion on this. So in our paper, we refer to the GDP because this is the target which is included in the SDGs. So the target is referring to GDP per capita. But indeed, I personally am also, I have opinions myself. So here I'm not speaking as a scientist, but as Giuliano. And I think that indeed the focus on GDP per se is kind of leading us towards environmental degradation. And here we really need a shift in thinking more in terms of well-being instead of GDP, if we really want to tackle climate change and environmental degradation.
Yeah, I totally agree too. I would like to express my support to this vision. Ali Idevarazi, is thanking you for a very interesting presentation and then is pointing out a nice issue. He would like to know if you could add the meteorological models in your scenario to get it more complete. What do you think?
Yes, I think that indeed this can be done. And so the model I presented is very simple because I think it typically works also in this type of presentations to go to the key point, which is the interactions between social, technical, and natural component. But indeed, each of these components can be made more complex. So in the natural system, we can look into the meteorological model all the way to the ecological one. I show actually, there was one slide about drought propagation in which meteorological the propagation from climate variability to hydrological droughts was going through the atmospheric science part, meteorological drought system. But yeah, I didn't focus on it, but it can be possible.
Thank you. And as well, I guess, oceanographic, as we were mentioning, for the interaction in the coastal areas, I think it could be a nice challenge. From Ravenna, I guess Wacoma, that if I remember well, is a startup company, but I might be wrong. So very welcome. Lukman is asking giving a technical question. Do you think that interbasin water transfer could revive water scarcity in the region, and also like South Africa, and also Do you think that land use changes in the model could inform about the irrigation strategy?
Yeah.
So it's okay. Asking about basin water transfer.
Yeah. So the basin water transfer can be an option to deal with water scarcity, but it can also backfire. So there is in fact a paper about water transfer in Iran showing how this can potentially backfire in the long term. And the concept is very similar to the supply demand cycle I mentioned before. As soon as more water is available in a place, water demand increases. And it increases for multiple reasons. We can have more urbanization in this area. We can have agricultural intensification. And then the question is, will this be sustainable in the long term? Because we are artificially bringing water into some areas, such as the Southwest in the United States or South Africa or some areas in Australia, which when we have a very prolonged drought conditions, we cannot provide this water. And meanwhile, we have a lot of reliance on this water. We have many activities. We have farmers relying on this. So we make the potential impact of droughts much worse. So one, I'm not saying yes or no, because it depends on the specific concept. My point is, let's try to consider all the different interactions and how not only the short-term effects, which will be to have more water in this area, but also the legacy that this will have in the long run.
Thank you. A few left minutes, but also a few left questions. So let's try to do that. So Sachini Pathirana is asking, is there a difference in the memory trends between developed and developing countries?
Yeah, it is a good question. We don't have enough evidence to reply. So all I can say is that this is a great research question, in fact. But the longitudinal analysis I was mentioning before, I mean, with a model you can do whatever you want, but still I always prefer to start from what we see on the field, so from the empirical evidence. And the longitudinal analysis, so looking at flood memory over time, are very limited. And this type of case studies are mainly on high-income countries. So at the moment, I don't have evidence to respond.
Thank you. From the Abe Shehu Foundation, they're going back to a question. They're asking for suggestion for the people of a community affected. Little way of preventing and tackling droughts and flood issues. So like behavior and simple or easy to implement adaptation strategy. Do you have any example?
Yeah, so the there are many places around the world in which flood protection levels are not so so high, and there has been mainly reliance on resettlement from the floodplain. Recent positive experience in this direction have been observed both in low-income countries, such as in Mozambique, that has made a large plan about living with floods and resettlement outside from the floodplain instead of reinforcing levees and structural protection measures. And this has paid off. For instance, the 2000 event, if one compares two flood events, which were very big in Mozambique, one in 2000 and one in 2013, can see that the damage and also the, especially when it comes to fatalities and injuries, was much less in 2013. This was thanks to this this plan. There are also, at the small scale, you also see some of these green system or adaptation dealing with floods policy being implemented in places like the Netherlands, in which some of the levees have been removed to give more space to the river.
Okay, so many people are asking for the registration to show the webinar to students and colleagues. I give to everybody the link. Then a last few questions. How does architecture develop to not only cope with flooding, but harness the potential energy of the floods?
So is this about flood-proof buildings?
No, I think it's more how to harvest the energy. So because a flood brings energy. So do you have example of structures that might use even the energy of the flood in order to produce energy? Or, I guess.
No, I don't have a sample in this direction. I can imagine. I wonder about. I mean, there can be contexts in which this could be feasible. Especially in areas which are not heavily urbanized and in which flooding is seasonal and expected. Definitely, waves are used to produce energy, as this could be done. But I'm not an expert in the field, so I'm it's a little bit outside my expertise.
So last few questions, really. Tushar Agarwal is asking an interesting question. Can we consider the natural-based solution in the economic analysis? So how do they affect the economic analysis? Because then you have the problem or the challenge to provide, to give an economic value to a natural-based solution.
Yeah, I think this is methodologically, from the way I see it, is, as I said before, it's nature-based solutions are not necessarily different from the solutions we have presented so far. The difference is about their impact on the environment, on society, and on the economy. So in terms of methodologically, I don't change that. And then, as I said before, also nature-based solutions is being a little bit abused in the sense that there are very different type of options that are considered to be nature-based solutions. So I don't know exactly what the reference was here.
Yeah. The last question, let's say, because then we are running out of time. Alessandro Taberna is a PhD of Twente in the Netherlands. What do you think are the main gaps and possible direction in the emerging field of social hydrology? And that's a challenging answer.
Yes, so good question. The main challenges, I would say, is very much about how we can bring together information which is very quantitative. For instance, the description of droughts and floods can be made as quantitative as possible, with more qualitative information. I made the example of flood memory, but this applies to many other variables that we want to represent. And indeed, memory is not something that we can measure in the same way as the flow in a river. And so this is one challenge, which is methodological, how we bring together qualitative with quantitative type of study. And this also brings the other question, which is indeed also how can we collaborate between physical and social scientists, since we represent many of our issues are closely related to social science. And another aspect is how can we represent power, since it is power which has a major role in these human-natural interactions, how we represent this into our model. And lastly, but not leastly, is the unexplored field of water justice. What we see is that we do not only have an issue of short-term and long-term, which is complicated by these human-nature interactions, but also that some social groups benefit more than other groups from different type of options. How can we represent this?
Thank you so much. I think many people as a thank you also for the answer that you have provided during the Q&A session. We kept just, I want to conclude thanking you, Giuliano, for this very fascinating seminar. We kept 75 participants all along the discussion. So I think it was a great success. I want to thank also Ottavia Carlon that has organized the webinar from the, and Gianni Lecce and all the participants and the CMCC Communication Office for organizing this. Thank you, everybody. Thank you, Giuliano, again. And let's meet the next webinar.
Thanks, Giovanni. Thanks, CMCC, again. It was really a pleasure to be here.
Bye, everybody.